battle again. Here we are on this Wednesday, the 19th day of August, 2015, worldwide broadcast. I am your host, Alex Jones. Former Minnesota Governor Jesse Ventura is going to talk election 2016. What he thinks of Donald Trump, and take your phone calls in the second hour. Dr. Alveda King, the niece of Dr. Martin Luther King, will be joining us to talk baby part gate with Planned Parenthood and her criticism of the Soros Democratic Party controlled Black Lives Matters organization. She'll be joining us for about 20 minutes in the third hour. We will endeavor to have open phones quite a bit today on all of the incredibly important news that we're going to be breaking down. Also, I've got some comments at the start of the next segment, briefly, because I don't want to get too distracted with it. In hindsight of the extended interview slash debate with David Duke yesterday, that just left me with a weird taste in my mouth. It was surreal. And I'll tell you why I have that take on it and where I was coming from, trying to have a serious discussion. And I overall just am not pleased with the outcome because I'll break it down at the start of the next segment. First off, though, one of the big issues we face is the establishment's decision to go past automation and bring in robots to replace humans, even when humans do a better job. This gives the globalists total control over society. These are soldiers. These are minions that will follow all their orders, but also carry those out with an autonomous program. Leanne McAdoo reports.
The campaign for $15 minimum wage is gaining in strength, with several U.S. cities moving to double the pay rate for low-income workers. Unfortunately, the very people fighting for $15 are at the most risk of losing their jobs to automation. The Washington Post made a startling front-page admission: raising the minimum wage to $15 could speed the arrival of robot-powered restaurants, killing millions of jobs in the industry. That includes 5.4 million servers and cooks and many of the nation's 3.3 million cashiers, especially at fast food restaurants. About 30% of the restaurant industry's costs come from salaries, so burger flipping robots become that much more cost competitive if the current federal minimum wage of $7.25 an hour is doubled. And many chains are already at work looking for ingenious ways to take humans out of the picture. Today's robotic workforce is much smaller, much cheaper, and capable of doing a variety of jobs. Compared to the cost of an average annual salary for just about any worker, including minimum wage employees, the robotic workers' one-time cost and near perfection in their job execution is a very appealing option to many employers. A 2014 Robotics Business Review article, "How Robots Will Shape Future Employment and Law," estimates that by 2025, half of the jobs in the United States will be performed by brilliant machines and intelligent systems. Here are just some of the jobs that will be lost to automation: pharmacists, lawyers and paralegals, astronauts, store clerks, cashiers, drivers, soldiers, babysitters, rescuers, sports writers and other reporters, marketers, customer service, and factory workers. So the question is, if these jobs are taken over by robots, what will we do?
It's a difficult problem, and I was at a meeting where there were five Nobel Prize winning economists, and all they wanted to talk about was this question. Mm-hmm. What's the future of employment and the structure of the economy when most of what we call work now is being done by robots? And unfortunately, even though that was what they really cared about, they had no suggestions.
You know, you go to Japan and there's no one taking your order. You go to a vending machine and you order it. And obviously the Japanese economy has dealt with that.
Automation poses a threat to millions of workers, but it could create opportunities for a few. And if the future looks more Star Trek than Blade Runner, robots taking over our jobs and producing more than enough of everything that everyone needs might mean the whole paradigm of exchanging labor for pay starts to break down. What if the need for work...
Gentlemen, thank you for joining us on this Wednesday, the 19th day of August, 2015. Jesse Ventura will join us in the second hour to give us his take on election 2016. He has been saying that Donald Trump's actually shaking the political system to its core. I agree with that statement, but is he a shill or is he for real? Hillary Clinton continues to unravel and melt down in front of us, with Newt Gingrich coming out, and he's a big insider, a globalist, saying he doesn't think Hillary will be the nominee. You've got, of course, one of the main reporters from Watergate, Bob Woodward, coming out 2 days ago and saying this looks like it's going to get a lot nastier, and as Nixonian. And just monitoring this morning, CNN, Fox, MSNBC, all of them, it was Nixonian, 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 Watergate, Watergate. So it appears that large elements of the media establishment are turning against Hillary Clinton. What does that really signify? And she's got nine lives politically, but, you know, she's used up a lot of those. And the Clintons are particularly nasty. People are tired of being bullied around by them, even inside the power structure. And it would be good for America. They were so arrogant to try to run Hillary and Jeb, for both of these dynasties to just go away. I mean, this is not North Korea, where you hand down power to your kids and then to their kids. This is not England. And you turn on the tabloid TV shows or the news, you'd think we were the monarchy here. I mean, it's the prince's child was photographed by the media at the park. It's so terrible. Oh, the royalty. Oh, they're so wonderful. Oh, Kate is so good. Sickening. And then coming up, poll, Trump closing in on Clinton. More signs of the global commodity slowdown is here. CNBC, U.S. Navy on alert, China, Russia to launch largest ever joint Navy exercise. Huge rollout, intensifying with major TV shows across the board and Vanity Fair's cover, Transamerica, our new special issue on gender, identity, and expression. Greater tsunami risk from Southern California quake, study finds, L.A. Times. Insecticide linked by some to honeybee die-offs found in U.S. stream samples. Reuters. Second Yosemite tourist diagnosed with plague. Head lice now resistant to common meds in 25 states. First almost fully formed human brain grown in lab, researchers claim, London Guardian. Another report. Doctors discover 40-year-old twin growing inside woman's body. Daily Mail, animal magic, meet the five-year-old girl who can hypnotize creatures with the stroke of her hand. I've kind of got a stack here about how fantastic this world is. I want to go over some today. Ashley Madison leak reveals thousands of government email addresses. That's right, 30-plus million email addresses and other personal info dumped by the hacker group. They told Ashley Madison to stop claiming that none of your personal data is held. Madison wouldn't, so they've now released it. And of course, they're holding your personal data to authenticate the credit cards. And then when you're going on and off the sites, Google's tracking that. Just understand, everything on the internet is being recorded and tracked. And they can also plant stuff in there. And that's what Ashley Madison is saying. They're saying they're going over this database. It looks like some stuff may have been added. Well, once it gets thrown out on the internet, who knows? I mean, who knows who's really behind all of this? I just know I'm not on it, so unless somebody sticks my name in there. Oh, boy. Truly amazing. And then I was sent a link to this out of the Oshkosh Northwest newspaper. Obama shares Mount Rushmore with Stalin in ad along Highway 41. An unnamed donor paid Jones billboards, no association with me, to put up a big billboard that shows Obama on Mount Rushmore with other tyrants. So great job, the listeners. We find out about new billboards every week or so around the country, plugging Infowars.com/show. So whoever the anonymous person is doing this, great job. More people are doing it. It's having a big effect. We salute you and thank you. Now, that's some of the news coming up. I want to dive into Hillary Clinton first. But getting back to David Duke, who was on the show for 2 hours, or a little more than 2 hours, well, we don't count the breaks, less than 2 hours yesterday. And I wanted to have a debate / serious discussion. And Duke said he would come on if I was civil and polite and nice. And he goes on all the other mainstream shows, alternative shows. And I thought, you know, I want to get him on to illustrate that what he's saying is less incendiary than what Mecha La Raza and racist black groups are saying. But that doesn't mean I endorse what he's saying either. And, of course, the leftist publications are now saying I'm buddies with David Duke today. We knew that would be said. We expect them to lie like that. What I came away was this, and I wouldn't do it because it's disingenuous, but I almost did it. During the breaks out there, when he wasn't on air, he looked like a different person. And it really was creeping me out. Then he puts this little angel-eyed sweetie face. Hi, I'm David Duke. Alex, I just want to help everybody and be nice. And why are you cutting me short? I want to be friendly. You're courageous to have me on, Alex, but don't cut me short. And I'm not going to answer any of your questions or I'm going to spin them. And then during the break, he looked very wolfish. I mean, he's a pretty scary guy, actually. I mean, I'll hand that to him. He's an intimidating-looking fellow, especially when he wasn't playing Mr. Cootsie. And then I was talking to some business people that are pretty high-powered here in Austin. I'm not going to get into it last night. And they were like, oh, yeah, David Duke's in business in Austin, Texas, and blah, blah, blah. I had no idea how successful this guy is. I mean, there's a lot more than meets the eye with David Duke. I can tell you that. And you know, I was kind of like some caller called in about David Duke. Like last Friday, I just kind of shot my mouth off and said, yeah, I want to get him on, and we'll have a debate. And then Duke wanted to talk to me before he'd come on. I guess it was Monday, so I talked to him about 25 minutes. I had to get off the phone. He's being so friendly and so nice and saying nice things about Donald Trump and all this other stuff. And then once he got on air, polished politician is what I think I'd say. And I wanted to have a real discussion with him because I want to get, if I could get Louis Farrakhan on, I would. I've invited him on. I've tried to get other leaders of the Nation of Islam on. Because I agree with a lot of what they say. You should keep your business in your local community. I want to empower communities. There's nothing wrong with people wanting to have their own culture and identity. If they want to go outside their culture, that's fine too as well. I'm a libertarian. But I don't agree with a lot of stuff that the Nation of Islam says as well. I mean, in fact, I had the Texas head of the Nation of Islam on like 16, 17 years ago for a two-hour interview. And they were pretty much nice on air, but put out their talking points. But once they had a couple big luxury Cadillacs the folks were piling into, once I took them downstairs and said, thanks, bye, it was kind of like a thing like, listen, you're white. And, you know, you may talk about some of the stuff Farrakhan does and want to empower black people, but we're not on friendly terms. And these were like big, strong, tough, you know, dressed up black guys. And it just clicked. They're in their group. They're into that. That's what they're going to do. Same thing with Duke. I mean, it's just his cult, his deal. That's it. Promote what he's doing and put talking points out and never really respond and address that the left is covertly pushing the real racist agenda. And I've got some more to say about it than I'm done. I'm going to get into all this news. But I just want to empower all of humanity. I just can't get over that need. And, you know, what I have to say about David Duke ties into this. Insecticide linked by some to honeybee die-off found in U.S. stream samples. Second Yosemite tourist diagnosed with a plague. This is the type of news and information that basically illustrates how much trouble human society and the environment's in. First almost fully formed human brain grown in lab. I mentioned this earlier. Doctors discover 40-year-old twin growing inside woman's body. Animal magic. Meet the 5-year-old girl who can hypnotize creatures with a stroke of her hand. Little Asian girl. There are so many positive things. There are so many negative things. There are so many fantastic things in this universe, in this world. And there's so many incredible challenges that we as a species face. And with genetic engineering and nanotech and all the things that have already happened, and the fact that robotics are being brought into place to make humans obsolete, and the globalists openly write books saying this is the plan, we don't have time to fight with each other over what color we are or what culture or background we're from. And yes, there are differences on average in groups of people. And yes, it's classical for people to be tribal and fight with each other. I mean, German tribes all fought with each other. African tribes all fought with each other. Mesoamerican tribes all fought with each other. It's actually natural and normal. And the globalists put out the idea that we're all on one spaceship together. We've got to come together. Then they double-cross that idea that Christians and real liberals and people that believe in humanity buy into. We stand down and then aren't racist. And then the establishment uses divide and conquer to make it even worse than it was before. And that's the great betrayal. And I wanted to try to have David Duke on, because he's moderated a lot over the last few decades, to try to say, do you see the eugenics angle? Do you see the secret eugenics? Do you understand the larger points that everyone's being targeted with fluoride, and that Margaret Sanger wanted to kill all the black people and was funded by the Rockefellers, who are heavily tied in with what you call the Jewish agenda? There's something else going on here. And what about Hitler trying to overthrow the U.S. with the Bushes and the Harrimans and others in the 30s? That came out in the McCormick-Dickstein Committee. Smedley Butler blew the whistle on it. They tried to hire him. That was admitted. And he said, there has never been any of that. That's never happened. That's not true. So it's just frustrating. And then Duke would sit there and say, you're not giving me enough time. You said you'd give me equal time. We went back and looked yesterday. He got, like I said, about 60% of the time, if you don't count the bumper music coming in. And so, fine. That's what I mean. It's always this victimology where, the poor Jews run it all crowd is being censored, when that's not what I did having him on the show. It's inherent, this whole act that, oh, I'm sweet and I'm nice and I'm loving and I'm good and you're cutting me off and let me talk, as an act of domination, as a debate tactic, where perception dominates reality. And now I've censored David Duke by having him on the broadcast and giving him more than half the time. That's an inverted reality. And I realize that I'm not going to wake up the Nation of Islam. I'm not going to wake up David Duke. I've just got to reach out to people that aren't invested in the particular sliver of the paradigm they're in. Of course, from the black perspective, you can say people are trying to genocide you and put drugs in your community and enslave you and ruin you and play you off and have racists that work under the system use as a tool against you. Of course, as whites, you can see the demonization, the attacks, all the things that are going on, and say the same thing. All I'm saying is pull back from it and look at the larger issue. I don't care if you're a white baby or a black baby or a whatever baby, you're a human baby. I don't want to see you shot up with a bunch of deadly vaccines. I just inherently don't want that. And I'm not saying Duke wants that either. I wanted to try to have a real discussion. But it's like having a discussion with Hillary Clinton or Rick Perry or something. They're politicians. They got talking points that are going to be put out, and that's fine. But I wasn't there trying to have a talking point discussion. I wanted to get outside the box and talk about the technocracy. Now, we'll look at the fall of Hillary Clinton that's accelerating when we come back. Buckley, who's one of the founders of InfoWars, really 23 years ago when I was trying to get into media. He was there from the very beginning helping me get on air. You'll see his name on the credits of my first four films. Buckley Hammond, who I finally got to move down here a year ago to work at InfoWars, back home in Texas, from Chicago, Illinois, ran in here right before the show and he said, you really want this article you sent to Kit this morning, you emailed, posted? Obama shares Mount Rushmore with Stalin in ad along Highway 41. This out of Oshkosh. And I said, yeah. And he said, all right, well, we've highlighted it. It says all these horrible things about you. And it was in that moment that I realized subconsciously and also consciously, I just really don't care. What matters is that whoever put up this billboard promoting InfoWars.com and that Obama's real father is Frank Marshall Davis, took action. And I'm not bashing Buckley telling this story. I'm just telling it as it happened. But it just shows how second nature it's become for me to not care when they say I'm behind the Boston bombing or I influenced it or I want to kill cops or I'm a racist or whatever. It's just not true. And so this is a sign of our success and our victory. This sniveling evil article I sent to Kit to be posted, knowing everyone will see through it. And because I wanted to be reminded today to read the article on air, not because it's about Infowars.com, but because it's about the tactics of mainstream media dinosaurs to just basically say I'm behind every violent action since Jesus was crucified. And basically saying Jones Billboard Company should not have taken the money to put this up, and they're trying to find out who did it. I bet money whoever did it doesn't even care if they're found out. But it's all part of an intimidation campaign that we're going to say you're linked to murder if you criticize Jamie Foxx's Lord and Savior, Barack Obama. And so that's why we posted the article. And maybe I'm wrong to post people attacking us when they do it all the time. Most of the time when CNN or MSNBC attacks me weekly, we don't even play it or cover it. Rush Limbaugh does when he gets attacked. I ought to copy him and do it because it is popular. It is interesting. It makes us sound big. But I only play or read a fraction of the attacks here. And I only do it to illustrate the tactics that they use. But I salute whoever put this up. We should probably write a blurb at the bottom, though, that says the point at the top about search who Obama's real father is. The top link, of course, is that it's Frank Marshall Davis, which is hands down true, hiding in plain view. I can't believe we missed it. That's why Obama, again, said when he was the editor of the Harvard Law Review, in 12 issues, I was born in Kenya. That's why his wife, in two speeches, the year he first ran, said he was born in Kenya. They're returning to his homeland so that we would then, when they said he wasn't, go, yes, you were. Then they put out a fake birth certificate that's obviously fake. So we'd take the bait like idiots. I got fooled. I just knew it was a fake birth certificate. And then insiders leaked the info. And the porno mags from the 50s and 60s with his mama, with Frank Marshall Davis, posing on the house, in the house, on the couch, with the same paintings that Obama's photographed with Frank Marshall Davis sitting on with his grandfather. And in his own book, Dreams of My Father, he admits he would live with him in the summer and was his father's best friend, a famous communist. We sell the DVD at InfoWarsStore.com. Dreams from My Real Father. It's just so crazy. And I know I talk about this all the time. I just cannot believe how truth is so much stranger than fiction. So we're like, you say you were born there. You say it the forward to books you forwarded. You say it in the Harvard Law Review you were the editor of. In the front blurb about, you know, the young editor. Your wife says it. Your family says it. But your dad looks nothing like you. His father, the communist, the economist, his fake father, was incredibly black African, you know, handsome black African man, but just super black. Obama looks nothing like him. Not the bone structure, not the eyes. Frank Marshall Davis, that's your daddy. It's like if you saw my dad, you'd go, man, that's Alex Jones's dad. It's ridiculous. It's absolutely obvious. And then he lived with him for over a decade. He spent every summer when he lived in Hawaii with daddy. Who do you stay with on the summer when you're out of school? You stay with daddy. And I've got stacks of news. I don't know why I just digressed off into that. It's just this billboard promotes Infowars.com. And Dreams of My Real Father. Great job. That's why I said, make whatever billboard you want. You're going to come up with stuff better than I am. So later, I'm going to read this. In fact, make me read this because I said I would and go over it. First off, let's get into Hillary Clinton here. This is kind of a mashup of her yesterday defending the emails. Clinton fires back over Emailgate. Here it is.
It has nothing to do with me, and it has nothing to do with the fact that my account was personal. It's the process by which the government, and sometimes in disagreement between various agencies of the government, make decisions about what can and cannot be disclosed. In retrospect, this didn't turn out to be convenient at all, and I regret that this has become such a cause celebre. But that does not change the facts. And no matter what anybody tries to say, the facts are stubborn. What I did was legally permitted. Number one, first and foremost, okay? Number two, I turned over out of an abundance of an attempt to be helpful over anything that I thought was even vaguely related. In fact, they've already concluded more than 1,200 of the emails I gave them have nothing to do with the work. Whether it was a personal account or a government account, I did not send classified material and I did not receive any material that was marked or designated classified, which is the way you know whether something is. What you're seeing now is a disagreement between agencies saying, you know what, they should have, and the other saying, no, they shouldn't. That has nothing to do with me. In order to be as cooperative as possible, we have turned over the server. They can do whatever they want to with the server to figure out what's there, what's not there. That's for the, you know, people investigating it to try to figure out. But we turned over everything that was work-related, every single thing. Personal stuff,
lies.
We did not. I had no obligation to do so and did not.
Lisa Jackson, the head of the EPA, had to step down for a secret email account. Not classified material, a secret email account to get around the four-year laws. Freedom of Information Act. In 1947, the CIA wanted to be totally secret and operate. People said, that's dangerous. That'll breed corruption and stealing and a takeover of government. They said, don't worry. Every 5, 10, 15, or 20 years, depending on how we designate it, it will be declassified no matter what. It's now how many years after Kennedy got his head blown off? 42? Almost 42 years. 1963, 2015, it's all classified. National security. 40 plus years later. Now they don't release basically anything. And she's up there saying, oh, I didn't do anything wrong. It wasn't marked secret. Whenever they've caught people in the congressional archives or in classified areas, remember the Clinton official got caught doing it, sticking the papers, Sandy Berger, in his socks? He would take the secret sheet and leave it, because he couldn't copy it in there, and pull them out and stick them in his clothes. And when he got caught later, he said, he didn't get in trouble. He said, but it didn't have the top secret sheet on it. These games they play. That's more premeditation, that they're sending classified stuff around and not having the cover sheet on it. That's a felony right there. I mean, these laws are in stone. She's obstructing wiping the hard drives. She is, I mean, it just goes on and on. Obstructing, removing the documents, altering the documents, having a secret email, using code names. Remember what happened to the head of the EPA. Just type into a search engine, head of EPA has to step down over secret email. There it is. Newly released emails show EPA director's extensive use of fictional alter ego. Lisa Jackson. Hillary has done this in spades. She is a criminal. If she gets away with this, she can get away with anything. EPA chief Lisa Jackson steps down after 4 fiery years. Not 1, not 2, not 3, but 4 years where she was running roughshod, shutting down power plants, harassing. Our last mine shut down under her. Our last lead smelting plant shut down under her. I mean, you wonder why I can't get a job in this country. Companies can't come here to get raw material. Finished. You see, we ship raw material out, but there's no finishing allowed for industrial use. It has to be done in China. That's a strategic move. So we have a lot of the rare earth minerals. We have a lot of the actual metals. We have a lot of the raw material, but you can't value add it here. You cannot value add it here and compete in the marketplace, because you can build a lead plant. You can build a steel plant. You can build a coal plant, but we will bankrupt you. You mean to play the Obama quote? We will bankrupt you? I mean, that's the arrogance of these people. We will bankrupt you. And then when the economy goes under, we'll give ourselves trillions of dollars and give it to offshore banks and then sit around and tell you how we're saving the world and saving the economy. And unless you forget, here's the clip from last Friday. Those clips were from yesterday evening. Here's the clip from last Friday where she said, hey, you know what's fantastic? You know what's wonderful?
That's all I could say.
She said, it's wonderful. You know, I started using Snapchat. It's great. It disappears on its own. Making a joke about her crimes. Here it is.
So I am delighted to be here with you and with my fellow candidates. And I know that people across the country are following us on social media as well. By the way, you may have seen that I recently launched a Snapchat account. I love it. Those messages disappear all by themselves.
If they're not punished, it sends the messages to criminals throughout the system. You can get away with whatever you want. You can do whatever you want. It's truly frustrating. But that's the arrogance. That's the chutzpah. That's the bravado. That's the hubris that these people have. And they think we're stupid, and they think we're done, and they think that there's basically anything they can get away with. And why not? From Missouri to California, from Texas to Michigan to California, they're coming in with zoning saying no family, single family homes. And if you try to build one, they won't give you the zoning, and you can sue them. And even if you do, they're going to raise taxes on you. So you live in a 500 square foot home if you got three kids, a 250 square foot coffin if you're a single person, and then they can charge you almost your entire paycheck in regulations, rent, and property taxes to manage and run your life. And they admitted all this 30 years ago in Club of Rome publications, and now we're living it, where the city of Austin won't let you put a fence around your house of any type, basically, now. You have to sue them. There's not even a law. They just say it's their policy. And they've got our kids in the public schools. That's why they're so arrogant. They can get away with anything until we just stop complying and start saying no. It's selling fast. It sold out for about a week and a half, but I brought it back as soon as a shipment came in. And that silver bullet, the highest quality colloidal silver you're going to find out there anywhere, normally $19.95. You can get it for 30% off when you buy a single bottle or buy two bottles and get two free. You will not find high-quality colloidal silver, 30 parts per million, anywhere near this cost. That comes out to $9.95 a bottle when you buy two, get two free. It is an unprecedented sale, and I'm going to run it until Silver Bullet sells out, because we're getting better about our supply pipeline. More is coming in about 3-4 weeks. And I think it'll probably sell out in a week, but whatever. I love specials. I love dominating markets. I love having the lowest prices. It's available at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Supermel Vitality is back in stock, one of the most powerful, healthy, focused, concentrated, organic products out there that you've heard the rave reviews, absolutely supercharges. InfoWarsLife.com. KJ in Portland, Oregon says, of all the products from Alex Jones, this is right up there with the survival shield. I've been taking it for 6 months now. I'd recommend this for sure while keeping a person healthy in all and other household uses. Jeremy goes on, and I'm out of time to read his, but it's, I've been using this product for 2 weeks now. Take a serving at 6 a.m., another at 12 p.m. on an empty stomach. I feel more alert, have lost weight, and my sexual drive has gone up. Yeah, that's the easiest to notice thing, just being scientific. It's great tasting, and I recommend that all men should use it regularly. I think it kind of tastes grody, but some people like the taste. I'll just be honest with you. That's a fellow from Denver, Colorado. Five-star review, InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. And thank you for your support. You make it all possible. So we have massive global developments. We have secret high-altitude weather engineering going on, geoengineering on a mass scale. That's classified. We've got the water and food being manipulated. We've got Al-Qaeda being put in charge with ISIS of large areas of the Middle East. The former defense intelligence chief who just quit a few months ago goes on TV and says we were ordered to fund ISIS. No one gets in trouble. Another general goes public warning the public. No one gets in trouble. They're shutting off our energy grid. They're opening our borders. It'd be like if an asteroid was coming to destroy the Earth. Would humanity come together to put the technology we need together and the resources to go up there and remove the asteroid? Either put rockets on it and get it out of the way or blow it up. Destroy it. Because basically, metaphorically, that's what we're facing. And that's why I don't want to fight with the Mecha La Raza people. I don't want to fight with the white nationalist David Duke. I don't want to fight with the Nation of Islam. I don't want to fight with the Catholics and the Jews. And it's just stupid. And I get in resource wars, tribalism's a great way to get people to go your way, but it's going to destroy us in the end. And the globalists have totally betrayed the people that followed them. The globalists sold the idea of working together and not being racist to try to build this system, and it was always there to just to make it even worse. And that's why it's evil. That's why it's out of control. That's why I have such a big problem with people that I try to talk to about this, and they just go, oh, you're a conspiracy theorist about all this. And I'm like, no, there's a whole program 100 times bigger than the Manhattan Project worldwide, and just what we know about it is thousands of trillions have been committed to it in the future. Over 100 trillions clearly been spent or more. That's a conservative estimate. It looks like a breakaway civilization with an attempt to get AI in control and just end humanity as we know it. And I know I've said that 500 times, but I'll say it again. That's what the globalists are telling us is coming. It's fantastical. It's amazing. They've got CERN that can open up different dimensions and create black holes and interdimensional vortexes. They admit that. We're reaching the Atlantean moment, and everyone can feel it in their gut. Everyone can see what's going on, can understand what's happening. They've proven humans have connections telepathically to each other and to animals. Daily Mail is reporting on that today. There's just a lot of stuff going on that the establishment doesn't want us to think about, because if we do, we'll transcend them by seeing how pathetic they are. And I just don't want to fight with everybody anymore. I don't want to fight with the cops. People notice the last 4 or 5 years I've backed off the police because they're in the same brainwashed, manipulated position everybody else is. There's good ones, there's bad ones. But they're humans, and we're all in this together. I'm tired of it. I'm sick of gaming the system. I want to stop the system. I'm sick of people that want to play within the paradigm. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of people that think because they can manipulate the system, they're getting ahead. It's like cancer. If it had a consciousness, would think it was dominating, would think it was taking over, would think it was in control. But it's not. You're going to kill the host. Even if you're a parasite, you shouldn't be for this system. But it's the nature. Jesse Ventura is coming up to talk election.
China rocked the world's financial markets this week by devaluing its currency for 3 days in a row, the biggest devaluation they've had in 2 decades. But 41 years ago, Nixon announced executive orders that rocked the world with not only currency devaluation, but created a new currency world order. In August 1971, Nixon announced a series of policies created by executive order and remembered by historians as the Nixon shock. It's still felt by average Americans, along with the repercussions of Nixon and Kissinger secretly laying the groundwork in China a month earlier that would decimate American manufacturing and leave us a debtor to China.
I have directed Secretary Connally to suspend temporarily the convertibility of the dollar into gold.
Nixon enacted wage and price controls, he imposed a 10% import tax, and he devalued U.S. currency by breaking the Bretton Woods Agreement that had tied 44 nations' currency to a U.S. dollar that was redeemable in gold.
Well, when the president does it, that means that it is not illegal.
Nixon portrayed the move as protecting Americans from speculators.
In recent weeks, the speculators have been waging an all-out war on the American dollar.
Nixon lied. It wasn't foreign speculators manipulating and destroying the dollar. It was the private Federal Reserve that was destroying the dollar's value. And the Fed did so with the full agreement and cooperation of the government, ignoring the Bretton Woods Agreement to tie the dollar to gold. Before World War II ended, Western nations had agreed at Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, to tie their currencies to the U.S. dollar, which would in turn be tied to gold. At the time, the U.S. was economically dominant and had over 50% of the world's gold. But the Federal Reserve ignored the link to gold and had been printing more currency than the U.S. had gold to back for years. The fiat dollars were being used to finance the warfare welfare state of Vietnam and Great Society Socialism. 5 years before Nixon declared Bretton Woods dead, the disparity of paper to gold had grown to the point of foreign banks holding $14 billion in paper money from the Federal Reserve, while the U.S. only had $3 billion worth of gold to cover it.
Your dollar will be worth just as much tomorrow as it is today.
1 month before the Nixon shock, Henry Kissinger secretly went to China. 41 years later, we see the fruit of that opening. Multinational corporations joining with communist lords to use the Chinese people as slave labor. Slave wages are just one of many components of China's low cost of production known as the China price. The China price also includes copyright violations, disregard for the health of workers or the environment, and an undervalued currency.
Let me lay to rest the bugaboo of what is called devaluation. If you want to buy a foreign car or take a trip abroad, market conditions may cause your dollar to buy slightly less. But if you are among the overwhelming majority of Americans who buy American-made products in America...
Well, the overwhelming majority of Americans don't buy American-made products, do they? Most of our products are now made in China, thanks to Kissinger and his Bilderberg buddies.
So for too long, the United States has entered into trade deals on the promise of economic bounty, only to see workers impoverished. Industries disappear.
And the dollar of 2015 isn't worth what the dollar of 1971 was. In fact, it takes six 2015 dollars to buy what $1 could buy in 1971. In other words, the dollar has lost 83% of its value since Nixon, quote-unquote, protected it from speculators.
Your dollar will be worth just as much tomorrow as it is today.
Now these same globalist politicians and multinational corporations who've robbed us with the China price for the last 41 years are ready to unleash something else they've been working on in secret, the Trans-Pacific Transatlantic Partnerships.
It is a breathtaking event. It says it's designed to promote the international movement of people, services, and products. Basically the same language used to start the European Union.
These trade treaties will not only accelerate the concentration of global wealth, but will give us global governance. And the China trade imbalance they began creating 41 years ago is being used to justify TPP and TTIP, just as Nixon lied when he said he was protecting Americans from speculators. These trade treaties are just a head fake. They won't help us to compete with the China price. And as Senator Sessions has pointed out, after the treaty passes, China can be added to the Transnational Governance Committee without approval from member nations.
We'll be back. Great job, David Knight. Former Minnesota governor, best-selling author, TV host, Jesse Ventura joins us for the hour, and I'm not going to hog him this time. At the bottom of the hour, in about 25 minutes, we will start going directly to your phone calls. So that is all coming up. your chance to talk to Jesse Ventura, because a lot of people have been emailing me, calling me, saying, hey, what's his take on Trump? And I'm like, well, we'll get him on the show. I was out of town for 2 weeks. And then he went on CNN and basically said he's shaking the entire political process. So now the governor has a chance to really flesh out here his views on Trump, election 2016. Is he going to be jumping in the race? And so much more. Jesse Ventura, thanks for coming back on.
Great to be on, Alex. Yeah, you took off for a couple weeks and a whole lot of stuff went on.
You've got the floor, because I'm always jumping in and asking 50 questions. Up front, what's on your radar? Then let's get into Trump.
Well, I'm just waiting for the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals. You know, with my court case, they're due to hear it sometime in September. We've had 3 extensions, so we should be at the top of the list, I'm hoping. And hopefully we'll get resolved to the court issue of whether these 33 media conglomerates will prevail and take away unjust enrichment, which will allow them to defame people and do it for profit, business, and money, or whether the courts will stand up and say that the First Amendment does not protect wrongdoing. Just as it does not protect running into a crowded theater and yelling fire. You know, there are limits to the First Amendment, and I believe strongly that it's not there to protect wrongdoing and make wrongdoing profitable, which is what the mainstream media people want. But other than that, Alex, I'm just biding my time, doing my off-the-grid show and staying up on the issues as best I can, and getting ready to head back south of the border, that is, if I don't have to cross a wall to get there.
But, Governor, I know Baja's great. You're retired. You've been a...
I'm not retired.
Well, I mean, retired from politics, but we'd like you to get back into it. The big question people want to ask is, don't go to Mexico. Stay here. Get involved in the election. Even if you don't run, get out there and get involved politically.
No, Alex, no, because it's too early. That's the one big thing they're missing, the point that I'm stating. I'm stating we need to pass a law that doesn't allow elections to happen until the year that they happen. You can't form a committee, you can't raise money, you can't do nothing to get elected until 2016. I mean, this is so absurd. By the time the president takes office in January of 2017, does that mean the run for 2020 will begin?
Well, I get your point that it becomes a continuous political process.
Alex,
I understand
Alex,
that.
If I get in the race now, I'm wasting money, I'm wasting time, I'm wasting effort. If I'm going to get in, I'll wait until June, I'll wait till the pikers are gone, you wait till they're down to 2 people, then you come in. And
I agree
them.
With that statement. You were just talking about going back to Mexico.
I am going back to Mexico. I always do in the winter. What do you think? I'm going to sit up here in the snow? And what, go ice fishing all winter?
Maybe we can just...
I'll still be keeping track. Alex, if I win the presidency, I'm liable to move the White House down there for the winter.
I was about to say, why don't we just annex Baja?
It might not be a bad... Well, because then the taxes would go way up. You know, right now the taxes down there are wonderful, and their whole taxing system, believe it or not, is better than ours. Down in Mexico, when you pay your property taxes, they're due in March. If you pay them in January, they knock off 20%. If you do them in February, they knock off 10%.
I talked
and
to three people
wait,
today.
At age 65, your property taxes are automatically cut in half if you're a Mexican citizen.
Well, that makes sense. Our taxes are obviously way too high. Right here in Austin, I talked to...
Our whole system's wrong, Alex.
I know. I talked to 3 different people. I talked to 3 different people today, all of which had their property tax go up more than 16% last year, and the housing market is not growing any more than it was before. It's a total scam.
Oh, yeah, and property taxes, technically, they're only to pay for your services, your roads, your police, and your fire protection. That's what property taxes were designed to pay for. And our system is so wrong here. If you buy a home here and fix it up and make it better, they penalize you for good behavior. You pay more.
Now, let's get into Trump. I threw that question out. Your breakdown, I mean, I want you to really speak to Donald Trump, this campaign, the Hillary Clinton email scandal, where you think election 2016 is headed right now.
Well, first of all, I don't agree with Donald Trump in a lot of his positions, and that's fine. But what I do agree on is what he's doing. He is shaking the Republican Party to its core. They don't know what to do with him. He can't be bought. He's worth billions of dollars. So they can't, you know, if you put Trump in, like I like to say, if you put Donald in the NASCAR suit, the only thing on the front it'll say is Trump.
That's right.
If you put any other of these characters in a NASCAR suit of who their donors are, they'll be covered with stickers up and down their arms and legs of who owns them.
What would you be covered with?
Nothing, because I never took any PAC money. I didn't take any special interest money. And I only took $50 and $100 donations from regular people. That's I only raised $300,000 when I became governor of Minnesota.
So your NASCAR would say, we the people.
Probably everybody. Everybody that gave $50, and that ain't going to get you in the door.
Well, but let's keep talking about Trump. Go ahead.
That aside, I love that Donald is shaking up the system, and it takes someone like him with the financial wherewithal to be able to do that. Trump can't get bought. They don't know what to do with him. He's leading by double digits right now in the Republican race, and he's doing to the Republicans what Bernie Sanders, the independent, is doing to the Democrats. They're dividing up, and it's an amazing thing. It's what they did to the Reform Party, what the Dems and Repubs did to the Reform Party a couple decades ago when Buchanan infiltrated with all of his people and became the nomination for president and then destroyed the party. Well, it's reversed now. The two outsiders have come into the two major parties. They've turned it into turmoil. I love it. And Trump's leading and Bernie's gaining. And it's phenomenal. I'd love it if it ended up Trump against Bernie.
You know, it really does stump me to wonder how this will all end up. In your gut, do you think Trump is sincere?
Yeah, because he's this far into it now. I didn't think he'd do it in the first place, but he's been into it now. He's made every mistake you could possibly make, and it hasn't hurt him. And why? Well, Donald's not dumb. Donald and I have been friends now for 20, 25 years. He came to Minnesota for a fundraiser for me and all this. And Donald learned from what I did. And when you watch him out there, granted, we don't agree. I'm totally opposite him on the immigration policy, but we don't agree on everything. But he learned. He's speaking from the heart. He's using nothing scripted, and the people love that. And they're tired of these hand-picked puppets that the Democrats and Republicans put forward every election for the last 40 to 50 years. It doesn't matter if the Dem wins or the Repub wins. They're both paid off by the same people. Donald Trump is not. And Donald Trump may have his flaws, but in the big picture, this is the best thing that could have happened to America. We need a revolution, and a revolution in our government, and it doesn't have to be violent. It can be done at the ballot box, and Trump and Bernie Sanders are doing that right now.
Well, it definitely shows the ultra-massive anger and the political realignment, the break the people are having with the system.
Alex, look at the last election, the last national election. Only 36% voted. 64% chose not to. That's a huge majority. And if Trump and Sanders tap into that 64%, they win. Because 64 is higher than 36.
Well, you are a lot better than Bernie Sanders, and I trust you more than Trump. The reason Trump is having such success is he is exposing that a lot of the illegals that are coming in, just like Americans flee justice to Mexico, folks from Latin America are fleeing justice here. Even CNN admits thousands of Chinese women, sometimes 10,000 a week, come in on a visa for tourism, have their baby, and have it all paid for, and then their kid's a U.S. citizen, and Chinese newspapers advertise, come to America, get everything for free. Now, I agree, the immigrants aren't the bad people overall, and there are a lot of good ones, but the people coming here to do that are being leeches, and the politicians that allow those laws to be in place are. And so are you ever going to see the perspective a little more like Trump and I do about the fairness issue of these borders?
Well, then the first thing that you should do then, Alex, you and Donald should get together and lead the charge to take down the Statue of Liberty. Take it down.
Jesse, that's kind of a stunt statement.
That's what welcomes these people to the country. It says, give us your poor, give us your downtrodden.
But they didn't get welfare before, and they had to wait at Ellis Island for 3 months to make sure.
Wait a minute, Alex. Every immigrant group in America has gone through the same thing. Be it the Italians, be it the Irish, whenever it happened, they all went through the same thing. Nobody wanted them here. Everybody wanted them kicked out. Oh, they're coming here. They're taking all
A lot of that's Hollywood exaggerating it. A lot of that's Hollywood exaggerating it.
Well, okay, but take down the Statue of Liberty. Take it down.
Well, I mean, it is an occult symbol from France. Maybe they should take it back.
Well, then we should take that symbol down. And as
I think we should melt it down and sell the scrap metal and import more illegals.
Remember this, and all your listeners should be wary of this. When you build a wall, first of all,
it'll keep you in.
Yes. And if it's 20 feet, I'll find someone with a 21-foot ladder. And are you going to make it the death penalty if somebody goes
Let's
over
debate
the wall,
this when we come back.
Kill him?
Governor, stay there. We'll be back with Jesse Ventura. Jesse Ventura is our guest. I agree with about 90% of his political views, but the reason I like him is I know he's not controlled by special interest. I know he's had the government come after him and censor his television program. I know he really cares about this country. And I know that they lied about him with the Chris Kyle book, and that he stood up against it and was victorious, and they're still coming after him. And if people come after me with lies, I'm going to expect my friends to stand up for me, because I'm not a fair weather friend. That said, clearly, there's a globalist industrial plan by the Republican leadership, mainly, and the Democrats, to get cheap labor and to create political balkanization. Clearly, immigrants to this nation, German immigrants, were treated bad by the English immigrants, because the English immigrants treated those beneath them bad. That's just classism. And the Italians and the Irish and all the rest of it, and other immigrant groups, the Chinese were treated terribly. Probably 1 million Chinese died building the West. So I welcome all these hardworking, good people here. The problem is the socialists, the Ford Foundation, admits it as a plan to bring in 50, 60 million illegals from Latin America predominantly, have them basically all vote socialist, vote to take the guns, and it's game over. And you incentivize with paying for the babies, making the kids citizens and all this, it's not fair. I can't go to Mexico, have a baby with my wife, and then we get to stay there and get welfare. Now, that's what I'm saying. I get Ventura likes everybody. I like everybody, too. So this is a short segment, Governor. I've had my 2 minutes. You've got about 3-4 minutes to lay out your position on this. But I really think it's a cheap shot to say, get rid of the Statue of Liberty.
Well, to me, get rid of the Statue of Liberty, put up walls, and we shouldn't let Canada be immune. If you're going to wall off Mexico, wall off Canada, too, because the 9/11 hijackers allegedly came down from Canada and harmed us. So let's be fair. Let's put walls on both sides, keep out, and we'll end immigration and all that stuff. And I hope people are prepared to watch their food quadruple, because it's those people that harvest our agriculture. They're our slave labor that we have in the country. And it's going to – and again – I'm not for illegal entry into the country, but the point is, it's the people who have been in charge that have created this problem by the laws that they pass, the programs that are out there. How should somebody who's not a citizen qualify for a government program? That shouldn't happen. But by the same token, you put up all these walls and stuff. Well, then that can keep you in, too. And do we really want to be the United States of East Berlin and have tanks at the border? And what will happen if you climb over the wall? Is that you get shot? Is that the death penalty? Or what will happen if I climb over it to go to Mexico?
No, I'm not saying we become Checkpoint Charlie. What I'm saying is when these businesses hire illegals, they get in trouble.
Wait, Alex, you said I could talk. Alex, we are behaving right now, if you read history, we're just like 1930s Germany. We're looking to put blame on anyone but ourselves, so the Mexicans are the easy people to blame. We blame them for, oh, they're causing all our welfare. Yet, what's his name? Scott Walker just gave the Milwaukee Bucks $250 million of welfare to build a new arena while he took it from the University of Wisconsin-Madison education to do it. So it's perfectly fine for corporate welfare. But getting back to it again, if we're going to be that type of a country where we're going to put walls up and all that stuff, and then we have to be like East Berlin, because you're going to have to enforce it and you're going to have to behave as such. And we'll tolerate nobody sneaking into the country and nobody sneaking out.
Sure. And Jesse, I am giving you fair time here. In fact, more time than I'm getting to debate this. I just wanted to interject the facts that there's 6.5 billion people. Africa's population is going to 1.2 billion the next decade. Latin America's is going close to a billion. These countries are collapsing. There are hundreds who are drowning a day trying to come in out of Africa into Europe. And the argument is, well, we bombed Gaddafi, so we deserve it. I get that. I was against that war. The whole world's collapsing. Should the United States take a billion people and put them on welfare?
No. Absolutely not.
I mean, I'm not for these walls and stuff. What do we do?
We can't afford to even have our own people. We can't even afford the corporate welfare to build the Bucks a new stadium.
I agree. Don't build the new stadiums. Don't have banker bailouts. And don't incentivize the giant third world population coming here.
But let's remember something. The majority of the immigrants coming from are not from Mexico now. They're from Central and South America.
I know.
Where
I know.
Where our wars have turned them into refugees.
And I was against those wars, as are you. Let's talk about it more.
Exactly.
Stay there. Stay there. We'll finish up our discussion on globalism, the borders, the rest of it. Ventura has legitimate points. I understand his points. I have my points, and I want to finish up and then get into Hillary. Does he think it's Nixonian? What should be done to her? I hope he doesn't come back with a Ron Paul type statement, because I'm going to plug something here for a moment. Where Ron Paul's like, yeah, she's bad, but so are all of them. I get it. Some of them have got to start getting in trouble. Like Nixon. That scared politicians for a while. I mean, it's getting so obvious, so ridiculous right now. We'll talk to Jesse Ventura, who, by the way, hosts his own popular TV show that I'm a frequent guest on as well, aura.tv/off the grid, completely uncensored. Facebook.com official Jesse Ventura. Follow him on GovJVentura at Twitter. Follow us at Real Alex Jones as well. Now, continuing here, colloidal silver obviously is Mother Nature's antibiotic antiviral. And governments all over the world are now starting to adopt different silver compounds, you name it, as the antibiotics stop working. And that's in the news today, that more and more bugs, as you know, are resistant to or completely immune to antibiotics. I know personally, last winter, not this winter, but last winter, I couldn't get rid of a chest cold. Even took antibiotics, didn't even listen to my own, you know, rhetoric about colloidal silver, just because I've never been a supplement taker. And I guzzled two bottles over a week and just it knocked it out. I mean, within a day of me drinking a whole bottle. And I'm not saying you should do that. Talk to your physician, because it is toxic at those levels, but so are antibiotics. At 30 parts per million, not that toxic from the experts, but just check into it for yourself. Talk to your healthcare provider or folks. We have the same type that Whole Foods sells, same major manufacturer. Ours is less. It's just relabeled by us from the factory. Well, we go even down further, 30% off a single bottle, buy two, get two free bottles until the supplies sell out. And I'm doing this because we got another shipment coming in 2.5-3 weeks. I believe it'll sell out before then, but I like to discount stuff. I like to be aggressive in the market. I'm a free market guy. Your purchase helps fund this operation. I want to thank you all for your support. This stuff lasts years. Everybody needs colloidal silver. If I have a cut, whatever, it works better than old-fashioned iodine. But I put our iodine in there as well. So get 30% off a single bottle or buy two, get two free. That obviously is an even bigger deal. And we're not like Walmart or folks that'll or Target that are known to raise prices 1 week and then lower them and call it a sale. It's always the most competitive prices. So there you go. InfoWarsLife.com. Supermel Vitality is the ultimate natural, healthy stamina, libido, you name it. You've heard the right reviews. Has a 5.0 review at InfoWarsLife.com from third-party power reviews that heavily reviews it and is highly respected. Look into it for yourself. You've heard the callers. It has a 4.8 site wide, which is unprecedented. No other supplements are known to even have that. A 4.5 is unprecedented with other products on their site. Find out for yourself why these are such amazing products. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. With all the fluoride, glyphosates, and other chemicals in the water supplies, it's insane not to filter your water with a gravity-fed system that leaves the good minerals in but cuts out the glyphosates, the fluoride, and over 300 other chemicals. Pro Pure G2 blows away the competition. We have side-by-side comparisons and videos and taste tests and the lab results from third-party top labs of how good these are. We have the lowest price in the world, one of the biggest manufacturers of gravity-fed filters in the world, because I have a special contract to sell it at the lowest price and then have a 10% discount with promo code WATER at checkout. You will not find better for the price, period. Other stuff just cuts out the bad taste, or you pay twice as much to get something as good as this system. And we have the full family of systems there at InfoWarsStore.com. All right, here's the toll-free number to talk to Jesse Ventura. Whether you agree with him, disagree, have a question, hate him, love him, he's a big guy. He can take it. 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Jesse, you've heard my point. The world's collapsing in the third world. Serious problems. I get the West has helped do that. But still, the very same West that's helped do that is opening up to this, incentivizing it. There's a headline out today where third world leaders say New York is more third world than their countries. Don't you see a problem with unlimited immigration?
Yeah, well, here's my trade-off for you, Alex. Here's what I'll do. I'll state this. Put walls at both of our borders, take down the Statue of Liberty and say, keep out, we're full. But the trade-off is we have to bring our entire U.S. military home and let them protect our borders. No more bases throughout the world and no more wars throughout the world, because over 100 years now, we've been fighting wars all over the world. And so if you'll bring the military home, I'll agree with you. We'll put up two walls. We'll let the military protect the United States of America, but we close all of our bases worldwide. And we use the military, like General Smedley Butler said, to protect the United States and only the United States. Fair trade?
Jesse Ventura for president. That is an excellent idea. You know I'm a libertarian, and all these wars have been criminal. 15 years after supposed al-Qaeda attacks, ISIS is worse than ever. I'm going to talk to you about that briefly. But absolutely, we have no business being an empire. And it sounds like you want us to be Switzerland, where it's very hard to get in. You've got to be skilled. You got to bring something to the table. And they've got one of the highest standard of living.
I don't necessarily want that, but that's my trade-off. If you're going to guard the country and we're going to put walls up, then let's do it the right way. Bring our military home. We don't need to be having military throughout the world. Our military should be to protect the United States of America and us alone.
I have another plan. How about we get rid of anchor baby status and welfare and corporate welfare and slash it all so there's an incentive for hardworking people to come? A lot of these immigrants are.
Well, we could do all that by doing the military budget. If you bring them all home, the defense budget will get lopped in half. If the only thing we got to protect is the United States, we're going to have more money than we'll ever know what to do with. Because right now, we've lost over $1.7 trillion over there in the Middle East. Lost, gone. $1.7 trillion.
Absolutely. Gone. Listen, you're preaching to the choir here, but
down the toilet.
But it makes perfect sense. What I'm saying is you can't have all this welfare to incentivize lazy people, whether it's from Europe or Latin America or wherever, to just come here and have their babies for free and be able to stay. That's not fair.
Certainly it's not fair. Just as corporate welfare is not fair either.
I want to get rid of it.
And so, and that's fine. We'll get rid of all that. You could get rid of all that. You wouldn't even have to get rid of it if you cut the defense budget in half.
I want to get rid of the welfare. I want to get rid of the welfare because it ruins people. Jesse, let me guess. I bet you've never been on welfare.
I have not, but my wife has.
Well, welfare is supposed to be there for 6 months or something when you're in an emergency.
No. My wife came from a broken family. a mother and four children, and they're embarrassed about it, but they were forced to take welfare at one point in their lives.
Well, that's different.
So I know what it's like, and I know that it's a safety net that's out there, and, you know, we certainly can remove it. But then again, if we're going to remove that safety net, then we have to have stronger abortion policies. Because if you're going to bring all these unwanted kids into the world, you better have something for them. You know, the thing I love about the Repubs, they care more about people who aren't even here yet than they do the people who are.
Well, look, I mean, I get the point that you can't have this welfare state and then it's basically aborting these people anyways. They're just dumbed down.
Well, that's the point. If we're going to bring all these babies into the world and many of them are unwanted, many of them are poor, many of them are this and that, and then you abandon them and say, hey, you're on your own now. You got born, but you're on your own.
No, but that's a government policy of putting women on welfare and saying a man can't be in the house to create giant broken systems to be Democratic voters that created that.
Well, whatever it is, if you're gonna be tough on abortion, then you also have to be have a decent safety net.
Look, I get people that don't want to have another kid, and so I don't judge them. But the abortion system itself was run by Margaret Sanger. They're selling body parts. They're lying about it. That's my concern, is the people running it are very evil.
Well, you know, then maybe you better get in there and straighten it out.
Well, I'm trying. Hillary, okay. Do you think
The point is, like I said, I think it's very evil to take away the system, the safety net, and then force, you know, like Scott Walker, he doesn't even want, you can't get an abortion through incest or rape either.
Can't we at least ban partial birth?
A victim of incest or rape, according to Scott Walker, that woman has to take that child and bear it.
Yeah, well, I think arguments like that help keep it legal because it does sound extreme from the perspective of those that are for it. But what about partial birth? An 8-month-old baby could be cesarean and live. Why sell its body parts?
Well, I'm not an expert on that, Alex. I don't know nothing about that.
I don't either.
You're asking somebody that's never looked into it, and I'm not going to comment on it.
No, I hear you.
I don't know anything about that.
I hear you.
All I know is that it ain't the government's job to, in my opinion, to tell a woman what to do with her.
Well, I think this is good radio. I didn't mean to get in arguments all day with you, but it's important to flesh this out. And I understand
and
you believe
I'm
in your stance.
I'm a believer that I don't want. You talk about independence. You want government in your sexual activities? I don't.
Hey, you're for decriminalization of prostitution. I agree with you, and now Amnesty International agrees. Studies show it lowers the crime rate and the abuse of women.
Absolutely.
I say take pimps and government pimps completely out of it.
Well, the only reason it's illegal is because there's an exchange of money.
And government wants its cut.
Sexual acts between two consenting adults are all legal. The only thing that makes prostitution illegal is you have an exchange of money. That's the only thing about it that makes it illegal.
Well, I appreciate the fact you're not a hypocrite, because I don't know the details, but I would imagine being in the Navy, you're not a spring chicken when it comes to a little bit of fun.
Anyway, let's go to callers, Alex. You promised I'd have callers.
I want to do it, but you promised you'd talk about Hillary. I mean, I've been wanting to know, do you think we're about to see the fall of Hillary?
I think there's a backlash against Hillary. I get a laugh, though, about her emails and all that stuff, how everyone's up in arms over her emails. I would much rather have an investigation of the trumped-up Iraq war.
I agree.
And how we were lied to and all the millions of people, hundreds of thousands who were killed because of it, and the mess we're in today. You notice nobody, or I would prefer them to investigate us torturing people. See, to me, those are investigations that should happen. Hillary's emails, I could give a damn less about them.
Yeah. Well, what about the fact that we see Jeb Bush coming out endorsing torture last week? Did you see that?
Yeah, I can't believe it. You know, to me, here you've got a presidential candidate that wants to be a war criminal. I mean, that's what he's saying, because if you endorse torture, that is a war crime. His brother and Dick Cheney are war criminals.
Well, I love how he blames the Democrats, who've been accomplices after the fact, Like, they know about the crime and have helped go along with it, but they didn't execute the crime. And then Jeb Bush last week blamed the Democrats for Iraq when it's Saudi Arabia and ISIS that's running havoc right now that the Bushes are completely allied with.
Exactly. It's amazing. It's truly amazing. And I hope the people of this country wake up and see the facts you've just talked about, Alex. It's for Jeb Bush to say torturing's okay. We want a president who's a war criminal. And you know, but it doesn't surprise me because 90% of these elected bozos were never in the military. And the thing is, if we're going to torture, then we shouldn't complain if other countries torture us.
Now, if you get Jeb Bush or Hillary, I might actually join you in Baja.
That's who you're going to get, baby.
Oh, man, I tell you.
That's who you're going to get because on the Democratic side, even no matter what Bernie Sanders does, they've got these superdelegates. And superdelegates carry the field. So no matter, Hillary's going to get it because she's got the superdelegates no matter what Sanders does. And on the other side, they're going to get rid of Trump because they're going to say he can't beat Hillary. We've got to have someone who can. And so it probably will end up, I think, Jeb Bush and Hillary.
I don't know who's worse of those two. Maybe Hillary because she does that Joker face. She's just, I detest her. And it's not because she's a woman like Bernie Sanders says. It's just I'm sick of her. I mean, I'm sick.
Well, you know, maybe Jeb Bush because then we could cancel the Revolutionary War and we could say that we too have a king. King Bush.
Absolutely. Bush the third.
How many more Bushes are we going to get then? Are we going to get Jenna and the daughters? Do they come after Jeb?
When do we start calling them queens and kings?
Exactly. That's getting back to Trump and Sanders. That's why I'm so happy to see both of them on the scene because it's disrupting. They've had it cushy now for 50 years. The only person that caused them some trouble was Ross Perot. And they got rid of Ross real quick when they wouldn't let him debate in 96.
They did.
That ended Perot. But anyway.
Do you worry about them going after Trump? Because Perot said he was threatened by the Bushes, and I believe it. Said his daughters were threatened. I mean, they're not above doing that.
Well, that was one of the reasons I came out and said that Trump needs to take me as a running mate for his own insurance. Because then if they kill him, they're left with me. And I'm worse.
That's a good idea. So you would run as Donald Trump's running mate?
Well, I'd absolutely consider it. If he asked me and he got the nomination, I would give it. Donald's been a friend for 25 years. I owe him that much respect to at least consider it.
So you think he's for real running for president?
I don't think. Yeah, I think he is. I don't think he would have did and taken all the grief he's taken if he wasn't serious about it. If he's not serious about it, well, then he's got the most wild sense of humor I've ever seen.
Jesse Ventura, T-Info here. Wow, he would run with Donald Trump. That's a news-making statement. All right,
well, and Donald may not want me. The Republicans certainly wouldn't want me. I'm pro-choice, you know. But if Donald's going to tear things up and get everyone ticked, who would be a better choice than me?
You'd be a great choice, and you certainly have integrity, even if folks disagree with some of your policies. They know where you stand, and that's a valuable commodity.
Well, and that's what a VP is for. A VP is there to give the president advice. Whether the president takes it or not is up to the president.
But and to be a designate backup.
Thinking you've got to be an honest VP. Well, you can't just go along and get along.
You would definitely get a lot of independents and Democrats to vote for Trump and moderate his ticket. It's a very, very interesting idea. Let's go to some phone calls. We're going to skip this network break because I'm going to them late. Sean, Tom, Peter, Kenny, and Brandon, I'll be able to get to you. Others will have to get to in the next hour. Dr. Alveda King is going to be joining us to talk about Black Lives Matter. Sean in Florida, you're on the air with Jesse Ventura. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Alex, you're a patriot as well as Governor Ventura. Wanted to ask both of you what your current opinion is on the email scandal. Now, I know Jesse touched upon it briefly just a few minutes ago, but I've got a good feeling that his point of view is going to change if the topic of Benghazi comes up on those emails, which is should be really the truth.
That's right. The ordered stand downs of the Navy SEALs got killed. We know she's been caught lying. That's the whole issue is, you know, Al Capone got it for income tax evasion, not for his big crimes. What do you think is going to happen to Hillary?
I don't know what will happen to Hillary, but like I've said before, if they truly want to investigate some stuff, investigate the Trump up to the Iraq war and investigate the torture. And to me, those are both higher than anything in Benghazi. Yes, Benghazi was a tragedy. A handful of people died. How many people have died as a result of our invasion of Iraq who had nothing to do with 9/11?
Thank you, Sean. Good question. But Jesse, I mean, I agree with you. But anything we can burn these criminal politicians with, it'll scare the other ones for some of them to start getting in trouble or stepping down like Nixon. So I don't care who they are, if it's John Boehner, Hillary Clinton, or any of them, I want to see them get in trouble. And she is obstructing justice, wiping the emails. She has been caught covering up Benghazi. She's up there making jokes about it. I mean, I would like to see her fall, and then there wouldn't be this Teflon image for all these crooks in government.
Well, that's true, Alex, but I would like to see a few others fall first who did much more heinous things.
Yeah, we know 9/11's an inside job, and we're trying to get the 28 pages out, and as soon as we can prove who actually did it...
How about that? I think that's way more important to learn about the redacted pages of the 9/11 report.
I agree. I had the congressman on last week trying to get him out.
Yeah, I mean, to me... there should be an outcry for that. You notice there's no outcry for that, is there?
No.
You don't hear any outcry. All you hear is, we want Hillary's emails. I want to see the 28, or whatever it is, redacted pages of the 9/11 report.
Well, I've talked to the congressman and the senator that have seen it, and it says Saudi Arabia ran the attacks, NORAD was ordered to stand down. It would send... Cheney clearly was in control. It would send him to prison. Let's talk to Tom in Maryland. Tom, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Mr. Jones, I'll tell you, the past 2 days have been quite a show. I'll tell you, you have come across as quite the calm, cool, collected, level-headed, and professional orator and moderator, and that's unusual.
Well, I'm getting old, and I got three kids, and I'm burnt out.
Governor, I wanted to ask you.
You're destroying your image.
The truth is, I'm just so tired now. At least I let folks talk a little. So. Sorry, go ahead.
Governor, I wanted to ask you, or at least point out, as a former investigator for the government, a lot of times our biggest cases would come from small leads. And I agree with Alex. I think that these emails could be nothing. They could turn up something. They could turn up a lot. They could turn up just enough to roll somebody so we could move on to someone else. That's where we make the big cases. So I just wanted to point that out. My question for you, though, was about the economy. As a former investigator, I can't believe the incompetence in higher office. For example, when I worked for government, General David Walker was a comptroller, and I thought he was a real hero. He put out a film about the economy until not too long ago, I saw him deny the CAFR, the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report that the government puts out. He eventually had to retract and say, yeah, there is that, but it's separate from the budget. It's not.
And what is your question? Is Ventura aware of the separate slush funds in corporate investments that governments keep that's off budget?
Oh, wow, you're right on target, Alex. Yes.
We got to jump, Tom. You're a great caller, but I got a bunch of them for Ventura. If you want to stay on hold, I'll come back to you after Ventura leaves. In fact, he's gone. Jesse, what's your take on slush funds?
Well, I actually ran into slush funds when I was mayor of Brooklyn Park, Minnesota. That's how low, how deep slush funds can go in government. Brooklyn Park, Minnesota had slush funds that were worth more than five annual budgets.
Wow.
I mean, you know, and this is just the sixth largest city in Minnesota. And they had slush funds that they could have ran the city for 5 years and the people wouldn't have to pay any city taxes for those whole 5 years.
Yeah, we get technical and use the term like comprehensive annual financial report, but they're just slush funds.
Yeah, that's all. It's them. The problem is this. The people that get elected in office, somehow they think that their job is to have the city have more money when they leave than when they got there.
Oh, Austin's got like $5 billion in slush funds, they admit, and they just keep raising the property taxes.
And yet they'll cry poor mouth and they'll raise everybody's taxes.
Oh, and there's plenty of potholes.
Yep.
Well, of course.
I'm well aware. It goes all the way down to city levels, these slush funds. And what it takes is electing honest people, which means if you elect Democrats and Republicans who already participate in a barbaric bribery system to begin with, you're not getting honest people.
Let's go ahead and talk to Adrian in Missouri. He's bringing up an exciting topic. We're going to have these folks on Monday. The Oath Keepers are actually doing armed marches with the black folks in Ferguson to bring law and order. The media claim they were racist. But I've not found Oath Keepers to be racist. I found them to be great people. What do you make of black folks now arming themselves in Missouri to stop looting, Jesse?
Well, it's going to be interesting. I laughed when I saw the Oath Keepers, and I thought, gee, can you imagine the response if they were all black carrying automatic assault weapons? Holy cripe, the National Guard would have been out there, and they'd have put... So, you know... I'm not ready for armed rebellion yet, Alex.
Well, I'm not calling for that.
I'm not ready for the people to pick up arms. We have an alternative called voting. You can get these people out of office and you can cause a revolution without having to shoot each other.
Let's get Adrian's take.
I'm not ready to go to that point yet.
Well, I mean, to be specific, though, we're not saying armed rebellion. We're saying openly exercise our Second Amendment so folks know we have a right to open carry.
Well, yeah, but they also... could lead to some type of interference during a problem, too, and then what'll happen?
Well, they're going to march with 50 armed black folks next week.
Well, let's see what happens.
And their point is, don't be racist. Black folks have a right to march armed as well. I'm almost
Absolutely.
Scared.
We all do because of the Second Amendment.
I agree, but the point is that the black people are scared, saying if we march, the cops might do something. So we'll
see. They have reason to feel that way, don't you think?
I think so. That's why this
I
is so...
Do.
That's why this is.
I would think they have decent reason to feel that way.
I hear you, Governor. Adrian, real quick, what's your point on that?
Yes, I was down here on the ground with Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs while they was here, and I'm here. I'm part of an organization here where I'm trying to educate the.
Adrian, this is too important. Don't hang up. Jesse's got to go. I'm gonna come back and let you talk about this and get your take as somebody that lives there. Jesse Ventura, I hope you come back with us in 2 weeks again. Thank you so much. And
absolutely, Alex. Look forward to doing it, and hopefully I'll get resolved in my court case and I'll be able to talk freely. Bye-bye.
All right, take care. There goes Jesse Ventura. Third hour coming up. Adrian, I'm going to give you the floor when we come back, because I need to focus more on this armed black march. I'm all for it. We have Dr. King's niece joining us briefly in the next segment to break down All Black Lives Matter and her take. Alveda King and Abortion Gate, Baby Body Part Gate. And we're going to go to your phone calls, Anthony, Barry, Kenny, Brandon, and others. Ventura obviously had to go after an hour, but if you want to hold, I'll still be able to talk to you. Adrian in Missouri. So you live around there. You're saying you hooked up with my reporters, Joe Biggs and Jakari Jackson. What is your take on this whole situation? And last time I talked to the Oath Keeper guys, have they set a date yet for when this armed march is going to take place in Ferguson?
Well, they haven't actually set a date yet. It was scheduled maybe a couple weeks from now and everything. And yes, I do live here in Ferguson, and I'm all for armed black people marching with Oath Keepers, because when they first came through the first night that they touched down on West Florissant, a lot of people thought they was like with law enforcement, and I saw Joe Biggs and I ran up to him. I was like, "What's up, man?" And I had to educate people around, saying that, "Hey, these guys aren't racist. They're not white supremacist militia or anything. They're actually on the side of protesters." And when we was out there, I told everybody, all the protesters, I was like, "Hey, haven't you noticed that the police did not try any of their brutality tactics on the protesters while the Oath Keeper was out there?" Nobody seemed to pay attention to that until I brought it up, and it was like, "Yeah, you're right." I'm like, "That's because the Oath Keepers did not racist. They have 10 mission statements that uphold the laws of the Constitution, and they will not stand for the police impeding on our right to protest."
Yeah,
our
the Oath Keepers do armed marches in cities where they say it's illegal. I've done it with them. That's true civil rights, civil disobedience, where we could have all been arrested at these events in multiple cities. Exactly. This is the equivalent of coming in and sitting at the lunch counter where they won't serve black people.
And I'm actually here trying to get a group of young African Americans to join up, join Oath Keepers, and to educate them about the Second Amendment, because the problem that we as black people have in the urban communities, we play the what-if game a lot. And when Oath Keepers came through, we was like, well, what if it was black people that was walking around with assault rifles? We would have been shot. Well, you don't necessarily know that until you express your Second Amendment lawfully. You know, if you read up on the laws, then you would know that it's legal, because Missouri passed an open carry law last year stating that you can have open carry.
Sure, and so, what scares the system is, that's why the feds on record in the 80s and 90s infiltrated hundreds of militia groups with white supremacist leaders, tried to get them to join it, tried to get them to bomb things, were unsuccessful, so they pulled off the government bombing of itself in 95 at the Alfred P. Murrah building. What they don't want is good old boys hooking up with good old boys that are black, Hispanic, you name it, in a culture of liberty. If that happens and people start protecting their own neighborhoods, it's game over. And black folks in Southside Chicago will demand the right to guns, and those criminals will run. And so this is a very exciting thing. It's also dangerous. They could try to put infiltrators in, whatever. But we've got folks in there that know what's going on. And our reporters, and they want to be up there next week for this. I don't know if I'm going to send them, because they've done so much risky stuff. It's only a matter of time till something happens. They've already been shot with rubber bullets and tear gassed. But Jakari and Biggs, I don't want to go back up there, so I don't think I'm going to stop them. They're a great team. But just amazing job. God bless you, sir. How do people contact you? Adrian, do you have an email?
Yes, I have an email. But you can contact me on Facebook, Adrian Hubbard on Facebook. I should be the first person to pop up at the scene.
Yeah, I've heard about you, and I think I've seen you in some of our videos, right?
Yes, sir, you have.
I thought I recognized your voice. All right, well, God bless you, sir. Good to be working with you for Liberty. Very exciting. We'll be right back. Stay with us. We've had a couple callers call in today and say, man, Alex, you're being calmer. You're being more gentlemanly. You're being more friendly. People have been noticing I've been taking more calls when I do take calls. I am trying to be more calm. I am trying to not blow up on air. I know that's part of the stick, but it's not a stick. I lose control, I get angry, I get exhausted afterwards, and I can't make the films, I can't launch the TV networks, I can't get all the other work done I need to do when I have anger issues. And it's like flying back to the United States a week and a half ago, I probably had maybe $1,000 worth of stuff. I bought my mom some plates and some jewelry, and my girls some baubles and cheap jewelry and a bunch of knickknacks in Rome. And I bought my son a bunch of stuff, and I bought my dad some stuff, and I bought cousins some things and from friends and family. And I bought myself four or five shirts. Probably wasn't even 1,000. And I'm on the airplane. I've forgotten to keep all the receipts to remember, so I fill out the customs form. And I just say 1,500. Just to be completely safe, and say it's a higher number if they want to try to tax me or do some type of import thing. Though it's not an import, it's my personal stuff. And the lady goes, $1,500, that's $800's all this allowed. And I read the thing, it didn't say that. It was like $10,000 in money, you had to announce it. And I said, well, look, it's not even really $1,500. I just don't know how. She goes, well, you put false info down? And I said, no, I just don't have the receipts and had been asleep on the airplane. I was landing, and I just... Here are the bags, you know, if you want to look and see what the stuff is. She goes, well, what is it? And I go, it's like, you know, it's knickknacks. It's like, you know, stuff from Stonehenge, stuff from Rome. What's Stonehenge? And I'm just like, look, Hillary Clinton runs Benghazi, is lying about everything, takes money from dictators, and you're here interrogating me. She goes, fine, we're going to search you, go to the back. And I said, fine, but don't be smiling on a power trip. I'm not scared of you sending me to the back or whatever. I said, do whatever you want to me. You live in this country, too, that's going to hell. All these illegals, I see you just letting straight through and ask them a question. But because you know who I am. I go, you know who I am, don't you? She goes, yeah, I know who you are. And then the next guy comes over, He looks at my passport and he goes, oh, Alex Jones, of course. And I said, of course. Listen, I'm being interrogated and implying I'm doing something wrong. I'm sick of it. You know I don't have a criminal record. You know I haven't done anything. Leave me alone. And see, there, I'm actually getting mad again. I don't like the fact that I did that. So I pray about it, you name it, and I'm just trying to get to the point where I don't have this temper. It's just the injustice drives me crazy. And I don't like being discriminated against. Man, I was watching people that clearly weren't citizens and were just coming in. They were just rubber stamping them into the country. But not me. And then the head manager comes back and goes, fine, and they have me back in this back room. Fine, I'm not going to search you. I don't think you have any contraband. I go, I don't. He goes, I don't think you're importing things. I go, I'm not. And he goes, you can go, you know, blah, blah, blah. Because I've come into the country before. A bunch of them are listeners. And that's why I don't want to act like a jerk. I want to be charming and not get angry and just joke with them and make them feel stupid, the ones that are bad. Because the woman was on a power trip. So that I can actually change their minds, not just be their enemy. Because it's not going to do anything for me or you if I'm just here angry. I mean, it's like the cops. There are some bad cops. There's some good cops. It's the direction they're getting, the programming they're getting that is bad from the globalists. We're not going to win them over by fighting with them. The globalists want us to have a civil war with them. I just don't want to get angry. So when a cop pulls me over now and wants to search my car, I go, hey, listen, I know there's a lot of criminals that use drugs and stuff. I'm not one of them. And, you know, the government ships the drugs in. And I'm just doing my job. Well, do you want your kids growing up in a country where there's basically checkpoints? And I mean, just you can see I don't have a criminal record. You've had me sitting here for 15 minutes. If you want to go get a dog, do it. I'm not going to submit to you searching my vehicle. Because quite frankly, so many police are corrupt. I don't know if you're going to plant drugs in here. I've done that about 3 or 4 times the last 6, 7 years. And you know what the cops do every time? They just go, all right, here's a ticket for speeding, or here's a warning, you can go. And it's not personal. It's just, I'm not waiving my rights. We have these rights for a reason. Because there's bad people in government historically, and I have these protections that George Washington fought for. So it's not personal with you. But I think you're trampling on the Bill of Rights under orders, and I think you ought to change that. Well, I'm just doing my job, and, you know, you do need to change that. I am involved. I want to get things done. And it's entertaining when I blow up and run around crazy, and I'm sure I'll still do that. But I don't want to have a heart attack when I'm 50 years old. Because, I mean, I really get pissed off behind the scenes. I mean, this is not an act. I get here and I read hundreds of articles about horrible stuff that's going on, and it gets to me. So I want to be polite. I want to be genteel. I want to do a good job. I want to cover the news. I want to reach people. And I want to try to stop a civil war happening in this country. And I don't want my anger that's been effective at getting people galvanized and listening to, at this now critical juncture where stuff's so dangerous, to hype things into any type of position where things blow up. Because undoubtedly, they're going to try to say I'm doing that and are doing that regardless of what I do. So I'm trying to up my game. Doesn't mean I'll be perfect, but I'm trying to really be a statesman, really reach out to people, and really try to make a change in the world. And let me tell you, I've reached out to the police. It's worked like a charm. Other than the Spokane sheriff that keeps lying about what we say and what we do, and then I want to get cops killed, and I'm horrible, and I almost don't want to go there now. I think it might be a setup or something, how this guy lies and does all this bad stuff and worships the Southern Poverty Law Center. But I said I'm going, so I will go. It'll have to be in the winter or spring, because I got to launch this TV network and stuff first, but just the way he tries to start fights with patriots, I think the feds may have told him to do this. And they may be getting ready to pull something off to blame us in Spokane. I've now been researching the sheriff and looking into him, and I think we got an operative on our hands here, a really bad guy. So we're investigating him right now. Any intel folks have got on him that's legal and lawful, send it to us at showtips@infowars.com. But I think he's an Obama operative. I mean, I don't think there's any doubt about it. But also, I don't want to walk in any trap. Because I started really looking at it, and it looks like he's trying to bait people. He says we're liars that his deputy said they got armored vehicles for constitutionalists. It's on stinking video. And then he said that I was death threatening them, and we called the newspaper earlier this year, and they had to say, okay, you didn't. I mean, you know, the guy's a liar. See, I'm starting to get mad. And it's just like, what is he doing? My instincts, I had something happen this morning, I'm not going to get into it, it's private, where it was like a record, like a needle coming off a record that I knew something was going on. And I went and checked, and it was going on. You know, it's like with my kids, I'll have a feeling just randomly once a month or something that something's going on, and I'll just go and check, and sure enough, it's going on. I'll, like, go right to where it's going on. Instinct, gut, whatever you call it, something's going on with this sheriff, and we're investigating him. I'm just going to leave it at that. Something's going on, and we all need to be on the lookout for the globalists pulling off another Oklahoma City and blaming us. We're in that season. We're in that zone. And I get chills big time when I talk about it because we're so close. We're so close to the globalists dropping the hammer. And then it's going to be so rough for this country. We got Kenny and Brandon and Barry and Anthony and Tim. And I'll get to all of you. And we've got this other guest joining us as well. You know, I said I'd get to this and I never did. But the article's up on Infowars.com. Obama shares Mount Rushmore with Stalin in an ad along 41. That's out of Oshkosh. I'm going from memory. Is Oshkosh in Michigan or in Wisconsin? Yeah, it's Wisconsin. I thought I was right. And you read this thing. I may do a special report on it just to analyze the propaganda. And a listener put up this billboard. And it goes, they won't say he put it up. We're trying to find out. It's so evil and bad to compare Obama to Stalin and Hitler. But they claim it's First Amendment. But boy, you know, Alex Jones is linked to violence and getting people killed. And all these people are connected to him. And, you know, and the Boston bomber is connected to him. And the theater shooting. And this is all pure bull. And the theater shooting is connected to him. And he runs a syndicated radio program. And this is dangerous. And he's linked to Giffords getting shot, the congresswoman. And then they quote me out of context to act like that I think violence is okay. And it's just the formulaic nature of this thing is so creepy that they want to intimidate people. Like, we're going to find out who put the billboard up, and we're going to, and it's connected to violence. And we called the billboard company Jones to ask why they did it. All like they control reality. They're the arbiters of what's okay. Like we're 5 years old and they're our daddy, our mommy, our big brother. I mean, it's just the condescension, all of it. I mean, you read it. The Boston bombing, everything, it's all my fault. They're back at it. Wait till they blow up a federal building. I guarantee you they're going to blame me, the Drudge Report, WorldNet Daily, and Rush Limbaugh, and you, libertarians. I'm going to jam in some phone calls ahead of a guest just popping in, Dr. Elvita King, priestforlife.org, the niece of Dr. Martin Luther King, just to get her take on this Planned Parenthood situation, which we all ought to be really happy. I mean, it's really coming out, and so many globalists are in trouble. And I don't mean people that buy into it's a right of a woman, and they've got their arguments, the people that support abortion that are low level. Their hearts are right. They don't think they're hurting anything. They think it's a blob of flesh. It's the people on top know exactly what they're doing. That's the difference. Notice Jesse Ventura, when I started getting into partial birth abortion, I don't know anything about that. I don't want to talk about that. Because he's never been involved in any of that. He doesn't get it. He buys the propaganda that sold abortion in the 70s. And I disagree with him on it. But he's not involved in the racket. And that's what the Bible says, whether you believe it's philosophy or real, about King David. He did lots of bad stuff, but he did it when he was out of control, and he repented to God afterwards and really repented and was a man after God's heart. He wanted to do good. He wanted to be a good person. He gravitated towards the good, but his good side was so big, you're going to have the other side that was bad. And I'm sick of hypocrites that sit around acting like they're perfect. It's a new, like, Pharisee religion, this political correctness, where they're all politically correct, and they use the proper language, and now mom and dad, husband and wife, boy and girl can't be used? Imagine if you heard about the cult in Colorado got rid of the names man and woman, husband and wife, boy and girl. They called them purple penguins. You'd be like, what a fruitcake group. Controlling language, cult 101. But our government does it. It's like, Michelle Obama says what I eat and how I talk. I'm in a cult. Well, I'm not in a cult. I'm in a cult of freedom, cult of choice, cult of protecting life, because I want to be treated like that. Because my soul is big. And when I even think about something bad, I shake. I don't need anybody to tell me what's moral and what's not. It's all written on my heart. And I just don't know how these people can do all this bad stuff and not feel it. I try to get in the mind of people that want to abort minorities. And I get there winding the minorities up to hate me. And, you know, and there's arguments there. But I start thinking about going along with killing the black people. I mean, man, my soul goes, well, you know where you're going. I mean, and again, that's not even entertaining it. That's getting in the mindset of the globalist. That's what I do. That's what you do in warfare, is you think like they do to understand what they're going to do. And, man, I get in their mindset, and it's like, I mean, I just get scared of God. I mean, I get chills the minute I even think like they do. Man, I mean, I got chill bumps right now just thinking about it. So we'll have her on about 10 minutes. Then before I end the show, I'll go to Kenny, Brandon, Barry, Anthony, Tim, and others, I promise. Briefly, we fund our operation because of your support. We sell high-quality products that are game-changers, whether it's water filtration, books, videos, T-shirts, Troy radios, non-GMO, non-hybrid, heirloom seeds, lowest price, highest quality. Brainforce massively sold up front and slowed down, but still selling quite nicely. It's going to sell at any minute at InfoWarsLife.com. Amazing brain pill. Read about it. Watch the informational videos. Super Male is back in. Read the reviews. Major game changer. Silver Bullet is back in. But I'm going to go ahead and bring back the sale that sold it out a few weeks ago because it came back in. 30% off a single bottle. Already the lowest price. Highest quality, 30 parts per million. Best manufacturer in the country. Buy two, get two bottles free. That special is also running. That's a better deal. But 30% off is a great deal if you just want one bottle. Absolutely essential. So many uses. Read the details at InfoWarsLife.com today. And here's a few of the reviews. Here's Svetlan K. in Staten Island, New York. Always good, high-quality products at reasonable prices. I'll reorder again. Thank you. KJ in Portland, Oregon, of all the products from Alex Jones, this is right up there with the Survival Shield. I've been taking it for over 6 months now. I'd recommend this for sure with keeping a person healthy and other household issues. Would recommend this to a friend. There's the reviews for Silver Bullet. And don't worry, we're getting more in a few weeks, 2-3 weeks, so when it sells out, it'll be all right. But I'm just telling you, I'm offering a discount on something to move it. It's already going to sell out. But I just want to give folks a super good deal. So you get in there and check out the other products so you feel good about it, so you order more stuff. It's a win, 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 win. It's how I operate. It's all available at InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. Dr. Alveda King is part of PriestForLife.org, a bipartisan pro-life group. She, of course, is the niece of Dr. Martin Luther King. She's just joining us briefly here today. Appreciate her popping in with us. She's got the new best-selling book, King's Rules, on what Martin Luther King actually said on issues, not what the establishment spins and says he stood for. And I wanted to get her take on what he would think of Black Lives Matters now, basically getting mad at Democratic candidates that say all lives matter. I thought that's what Martin Luther King said, what common sense says. Storming these events, taking them over, being Democratic Party funded, George Soros funded. What does she think, as you know, having a lot of savvy on how politics works, is going on here? And how big a victory is it, because she's a big opponent of, obviously, abortion that predominantly targets blacks, 50-plus percent being aborted before they're born. What does she think about this Planned Parenthood news coming out? I mean, we got four states cutting their funding, Congress looking at it. We've known this is going on for a while, but it really is good to see this evil being exposed. So, Dr. King, thank you so much for coming on with us.
I am so glad to join you, and those are some wonderful questions and things that you pointed out. The first thing I thought, and you know I come from a family of preachers, Martin Luther King Jr. is a preacher, my daddy is Brother A.D., my granddaddy, Daddy King. I'm an evangelist. But there was a time in the Bible when there was a man named Joseph, and he became very well known to the Pharaoh after he went through persecution and all that. And then when he died, a new Pharaoh came, and then they said they didn't remember Joseph. I'm thinking that some people don't even remember Martin Luther King Jr., what he stood for. And, of course, he stood for God. He was a man of God. He loved God. And a lot of people seem to have forgotten that. And that's why you can see young people running up, interrupting a meeting, yelling Black Lives Matter. And, of course, Black Lives Matter. All lives matter. Martin Luther King Jr. often taught, my daddy, A.D., his brother, too, Acts 17:26, of one blood, God made all people, so we're brothers and sisters. And Martin Luther King says we have to learn to live together as brothers, and all that as sisters will perish as fools. So they don't remember that. And so they don't even know that it's disrespectful to go to a meeting and jump in the people's face and scream, Black Lives Matter. That's disrespectful. But no one has taught them how to articulate a need. And because they don't know how, they're doing it inappropriately.
Well, we know the Democrats are directing them, and Nancy Pelosi and others, so it looks like they're trying to make the movement balkanize people and look pretty silly as well. They even go to the most liberal, Bernie Sanders, you name it, and get in their face. What do you think is really going on behind the scenes here, Dr. King?
Well, what there's envy and confusion, envy and strife, there's confusion in every evil work. If you can keep things confused and people can't think, they don't even notice. Well, they're yelling at the Democrats and the Republicans. And then you wonder who's kind of behind the movement, who's paying them. Because I can remember, you know, I was elected to office myself. I was a state legislator 2 terms in Georgia. I've been a presidential appointee and those kinds of things. And so when you're in a campaign, you pay people to stand on the corner with your signs, to walk up and down and pass out your flyers. Well, people don't only do that when someone's running for office. They do it to disturb a community. And so you can give somebody a little money and say, go out into the community and scream and jump up and down, and we'll give you some money, we'll give you lunch, we'll give you whatever. So a lot of that is happening. And then sometimes young people especially, they'll see something and they'll join in and with all this zeal without even examining what the message is. And honestly, a lot of that's going on. And you're right, there are people who want anarchy and confusion, so that they can continue to do things that they're doing and nobody will ask them any questions.
And they want us
so
at each other's throats.
That confusion. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I mean, and they want us at each other's throats. We know Hillary has met with the folks and tried to stir things up. We know George Soros is doing it. And there are some real issues with the police in areas, but they're really trying to exacerbate it. And I think that's the desperation of the Democratic Party, not that the Republicans are much better, that all they've got now is divide and conquer. I mean, do you agree that that's a sign of desperation, or do you think it's confidence?
Well, I talk about frequencies. And so the political frequency is real and you're there, but it's not so much whether you're a Republican or a Democrat or an independent, but are you a free thinking person? Can you think? Can you hear? Can you reason? Can you look at issues? And, to, you know, if you keep the battle going between the Republicans and the Democrats, that's one level in one place. But what I demand is that everybody, regardless of their political party, do what's right by people. And that's why I wrote to the Congressional Black Caucus, for example, and I said, are you paralyzed? Over in the book of Habakkuk, it says that justice is paralyzed. People are paralyzed, and they can't even do what's right. And justice is perverted. And so what's your problem? Why can't you speak out and say that these things that are happening are wrong? A lot of time, money does it. Like you say, people throw money at it. People who are wealthy enough to want to manipulate the agendas, they put enough money out there that people won't even hear what's right and what's wrong. And have you ever seen those movies or things like that, and somebody wants to go into a community and the crowd is too thick, so they just take a handful of coins or a handful of dollars and throw them up in the air, and the people disperse chasing the money?
Yes.
And then they can go wherever they want to go? Well, then this is exactly that. That's the analogy. That's what's happening.
They've got us fighting over crumbs while they social engineer the planet. How positive an event, even though it's painful, is it? What do you think of all these abortion videos coming out and the fact that they're selling baby parts, what looks like on the illegal market?
Well, I hope your listeners are really listening, because it's very painful for me, because I'm post-abortive. I had abortions. And when I had those abortions, I was one who sat there and was rushed in and had papers shoved into my hands. And as they shoved the papers into my hands, signed this quick. And I'm already not sure. I'm trying to do it in secret, all of that. And then they shoved, you got to sign this, you got to do that. So it is painful. But, you know, and there's another video out today. I don't know if you see it. It's called Call Him Emmett, E-M-M-E-T-T, talking about Emmett Till, who in the 20th century, an African-American young teen, was killed for supposedly looking at a Caucasian girl. And his mother said, leave the coffin open because our people need to see what happened to my child. And so Martin Luther King Jr. said, America will not reject racism until America sees racism. Well, Father Frank Pavone, and I'm director of African-American Outreach for Priests for Life, where Father Frank is the national director. Father Frank says America will not reject abortion until America sees abortion. So even though I sit there and I think, oh my God, did I sign that for my own babies? And you think about it, but I still say people need to see it. I need, you know, I'm looking at it. It's hard. Sometimes I have to look away for a second and look back. David had five smooth stones. This time, the Center for Medical Progress had five piercing videos. The first five videos ripped the top off of this thing. And from there on, the videos are still coming now. So we do have to see them. They are hard to look at. But if we don't see the truth, our hearts won't be pricked. And so I believe that the videos have to be seen.
Dr. Elvita King is our guest, priestforlife.org. The good news is they tried to get the courts to block the release of these videos. That's failed. We now know even more horrific videos are coming out. And it just shows Planned Parenthood and others are not invincible. I think we're very close to seeing the fall of Hillary, Planned Parenthood, you name it, if we just continue to push.
So. I believe so. There's a book, Abolishing Abortion, by Father Frank Pavone. It just dropped yesterday. He's given a backdrop and 20 points of things that we can all do now that we've seen all this. So sometimes if you see something and you feel hopeless, if you don't have anything you can do about it. Ugh. So he's given some how-tos and some lasting things that we all can and should do. I've got a book, too, King Rules, R-U-L-E-S, K-I-N-G, R-U-L-E-S. And I talk about my own abortion experience in there. Father Frank did an afterward for me. And so we need to read, study, get involved, participate in the solution.
I agree, don't Dr. King. Mad. Dr. King, we're simulcasting, interrupt, I apologize, video. You know, we're part TV, not just radio, and the guys roll footage in the background. Okay. The new video out today is them harvesting the babies, getting their organs, their different parts, and their little eyes and their little bodies. Good God. Excuse me.
I tell you, it's hard to see.
Yeah, I hadn't seen this new one yet. I knew it was up, and I didn't want to look at it. And their poor little heads and little eyes.
Is that the lady who had to go and cut the brain?
Yeah.
To get the, I mean,
yeah, to put them in the mice.
Yeah. The brain. That's hard. I know. It's hard. I'm sorry. It's hard.
Well, no, you were talking about it. I hadn't seen it yet. And then, boom, it hit. Mm-hmm. What do you make of these mainly women?
Your face. Yeah.
What do you make of these weird, liberal type, fake women all gulping wine at fine restaurants, bragging about all the body parts? I mean, how sickening is how callous they are.
They're desensitized. That's why they have to drink the wine, because they're desensitized. And the only way they can go to sleep probably is to get a stiff drink. I mean, how are you going to keep your heart anesthetized unless you continually do it? You know, that's really... So I feel for them. I feel pain. I'm sorry. I pray that they can get to a place where they can live with themselves again.
Don't people at a fundamental level get, just to use this term, how bad a luck it is? And I use that term, because even if you're not a Christian, you get it. At a fundamental level, it just feels like bad luck for everybody to be doing this to babies. It just, don't people know it's going to come back on us?
No, people don't know. Because I remember when I was young, I'm about 66th birthday coming up. And I remember my mind was, oh, yeah, I understand. I hear that happens to people, but it won't happen to me. You know, you can always tell yourself that till it happens. And then you sit there and say, how did this happen? Don't you remember? Maybe that didn't happen to you when you were young.
Sure, it's like people I know that smoke cigarettes and then they don't believe they're going to get lung cancer. When they get it, they just can't believe it.
And then how did this happen, you know? And so that is part of the human nature as well. And that's why we have to do a lot of praying. I am a Christian, obviously. But what I say to anybody, whether you're Christian, not a Christian, is there anybody? Well, no, obviously there are people because they're swilling wine and talking about it. I was going to say, is there anybody who can't see how bad that is? But obviously there are some who are still.
Absolutely. Well, the good news is, as you know, the Bible says there's nothing hidden that won't be brought out, even from the deepest depths of the sea. It's coming out. I know you've got a new song out, too, exposing a lot of this. Priest
Pray
for Life.
Pray for America. Pray for America. That's the song. And you can see that at AfricanAmericanOutreach.com. Right at the top, there's a music video. You click on that, and then you can order it online, the whole song, I think, somewhere. Mm-hmm.
Well, I hope you'll come back with us and take calls for a longer interview in the future. Priestforlife.org. Keep up the great work, Dr. Elvita C. King. God bless you.
God bless you. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you.
Bye.
Oh, man, that really just freaked me out because I wasn't ready for it. And I'll be honest, I don't watch a lot of the war videos of kids bombed and dead. There was one I saw just the other day by accident in Syria, where the roof had fallen in on a father and his daughter's in his arms. She looks like she's about 6 or 7. I got a 7-year-old daughter, and she's crushed. You can see him holding her, and you can tell they died together, suffocating under the rock. And it just gets to me. And I just can't imagine people that don't have that empathy. It's like my nerve endings. What happens to somebody else happens to me. And I think about that bowl of little kids, and they're pretty good size. These look like about 4 or 5 month old babies. And their little heads, their little eyes, their little faces, and they're taking the brains out. And I'd tell people 20 years ago, they were putting baby brains in pigs, cows, rats, dogs, you name it. People didn't believe me. Now it's all in the news. It's just so crazy. That's what I mean. And we're got Louis Farrakhan running around and David Duke running around all. And yes, whites are racist, some of them, and blacks are racist, and Hispanics are in groups. And the media is hyping it. And so it's real. The real perspective of Louis Farrakhan or David Duke, I mean, I get their perspective from their perspective. But you pull back from it, it's so fantastical what's really going on. The evil transcends what they can even cover. And it's happening to everybody. I think that's the biggest lie, is everybody thinks they're getting screwed over, or if they're screwing somebody over, they're exempt. You're not exempt. You don't get away with anything you do in this world. And I just don't know how people don't see that or know that. Or why you'd even need to know that metaphysical rule. I'm going to go to your phone calls. I apologize. Kenny, and then Brandon, and then others. Kenny, thanks for holding in Florida. Ventura's gone now, but go ahead, your point.
Great show today, Alex. And I wanted to plug this ProPure water filtration system if I could. It makes the best sweet tea, and I even make my ice cubes out of it.
Well, God bless you. Thanks for the support.
Yeah, man. According to WorldNet Daily, since 9/11, 2001, an average of 26 American citizens are killed every day in this country. And if you do the math by illegal aliens, it's a well over 130,000 dead. Over 1 million sexual assaults, mostly against children. And I just wanted to ask him how many is too many. And if he puts illegals before American citizens, I'm done with Jesse Ventura.
Well, Ventura's got a real liberal streak in him that he just wants to like everybody. And he gets that the welfare is wrong and it's a draw. But I'm trying to get him to, he's moved a little bit. And I think it's, next time he's on, I'm going to go over statistics with him. And I'm actually going to go over those numbers with him and just say, look, we're not saying get rid of the Statue of Liberty. We're not saying we don't like Mexicans. That's not even the biggest group now. Chinese women, Russian women, African women, I don't care, should be able to come here and get everything free. And by the way, the illegals do work. But a lot of them game the system and get welfare and then work. And Walmart does it. Walmart tells its employees, We pay you enough where you can still get welfare. Go out and get assistance. So we then subsidize Walmart not paying people a living wage. So I hear what you're saying. And Ventura is wrong on that front, and he's wrong on abortion. Go ahead. Anything else?
That's about it, brother. Keep up the good work. We love you, man. We're praying for you.
God bless you. You know, I guarantee you that if I get Ventura and make him look at partial birth abortions, I'll get him to stop his views and everything. I mean, he is a real libertarian. That's really what Ventura is. And he's a good guy. He doesn't like the New World Order. He exposes 9/11. He got kicked off MSNBC and millions of dollars because he wouldn't show up about the war being wrong. I mean, he's good on many areas. He's a moral person from his perspective. We're going to go to break, come back with Brandon, and then Anthony, Tim, Barry, and others. I wish I wouldn't have seen that video, but you know what? Good job, guys, playing it. Because after I saw it, I said, you know what? Roll it again. And go to Infowars.com, and you look at this video for yourself. And, you know, if anybody tries to censor it on YouTube, which they've been doing, if dead babies getting harvested is obscene, why is it happening? We're not obscene showing it. You're obscene doing it. And I just repent to God Almighty that I didn't do enough to stop the abortions that I've been involved in. And then my heart and soul just says, that's all right. In the end, you know, you're going to be tested and you're going to pay for what you've done, but hopefully only in this life. So I know God's got plans for me. I'll pay. Don't worry. We want everybody to go to Infowars.com and get the new
Jesus.
It's not in featured. We'll put it there. Abortion video that's been leaked of the actual harvesting of the babies. Something Planned Parenthood denied, said wasn't real. I mean, they're a pack of liars. And when we're done exposing what they're doing, see, the more hardcore the globalists get, the more we're going to play hardball. Evil people always make the mistake of thinking good people are weak and are cowards. And the truth is, once good people know that they're cornered, they will tear evil people to pieces. And we're not going to do anything violent to these abortuaries. We're going to expose what you're doing and politically destroy you. And I can feel, as the evil intensifies in the world, good is growing stronger as well. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. Be part of the solution, folks. We're in an epic time right now, the beginning of something that's just going to get more and more epic. It's just so exciting. In a good way and a bad way. I don't know how anybody could be bored right now. Brandon in FEMA Region 3, thanks for holding.
Hey, Alex, how you doing?
Good, brother.
I wanted to touch on the growing police state. By the way, I'm a Marine Corps reservist, and I actually shot video on my phone about a month ago. I was driving down 95, and I could see what was clearly about 11 or 12 Blackhawks in the air, and they actually had a few streets blocked off, and I walked up and just wanted to know what was going on, and one of the Army guys, he had a Ranger tab on his shoulder, basically told me to shut up and get back. And, I mean, the more and more I see this, it makes me sick to my stomach because it's not what I signed up for.
Sure, and it's not the military itself's bad. They're being given these missions to condition the public. I never even covered Watson's article in California where they had thousands of troops total, but hundreds in trucks practicing in plain clothes, infiltrating, taking over the town, and then leaving. They're practicing attacking American cities for America.
And, Alex, it's not even noticed, and I can even attest to myself, when these drills occur, it's never about that jihadi with 50 pounds of C4 strapped to his chest. It's about that good old boy in a John Deere hat who doesn't want to turn his pants in.
So you've been in the Marines. I've videotaped this with the Marines. But in the Marines, you have trained to take on, I mean, I've been to the drills. They always wear John Deere hats and go, I love America, don't take my guns. And then the Marines practice taking them out. You're saying you've been part of that.
I've been part of it. I've seen it firsthand. And, I mean, to a lot of the guys in the Corps and in all branches, it's like, is this even America anymore? We're training to kill our own people if they don't do whatever the government says. And, you know, and you've touched on it millions of times, saying the FBI and the CIA is compartmentalized at the mid and highest levels, especially at the Pentagon. I mean, I'm the son of a U.S. Army general, and he's even told me, you know, you either play ball or they're going to say give in your resignation and have a good life, you know.
Briefly, where were you specifically with these drills? Were they in real cities or practice cities where you were practicing taking on veterans or patriots? Who were you practicing to take on, and where was it?
This was a few years ago. This was, it was in Virginia. Just a little, I guess about 10 minutes outside of Richmond.
Was it in a drill facility or in a town?
It was in plain sight.
Yeah, it was in a town. No, I mean, I know because I've shot or had shot for me probably, let's not exaggerate, 40 times. Video of Marines practicing to confiscate guns from South Texas to Hebron, Maryland. It's all on video. Stay there. I'm going to come back to you, Brandon. That's powerful info right there and powerful testimony. We know it's true, but just to hear it from the guys that are doing it. This is real. This is treason. Brandon is in the Marine Corps Reserves. He was talking about in small towns doing urban warfare drills. A little bit more, Brandon. I'm going to go to a few other callers like Anthony that's been holding and Tim, but any other tidbits you'd like to add? I mean, the good news is the reason the military is so awake is that they are being given treasonous missions. But the question is, when will it become institutionalized, and when will people think it's normal, or will that ever happen?
I think that in the case of the Army and the Marine Corps, who I think are given more of these missions more so than the Coast Guard, Air Force, or Navy, I think it may come down to where there may just be a mutiny like Dempsey warned Obama over the whole Syria thing. It may just come a time where people say, you know what, I'm not doing this. Arrest me, kill me, do whatever you're going to do to me. I'm not going to kill innocent people to further your agenda. I mean, and when it comes to stuff like drills, you know, it'll be in inside. It won't even be on government property, and people will be filming, and you'll have guys, you know, pointing guns saying, you better get out of here, I'm going to kill you. And, you know, it's like, it's their right. You know, they have a First Amendment for a reason.
Well, I've had a cover with machine guns, and our camera people have in Hebron, Maryland, say, turn your cameras off. That's in Police Day 2000. You're saying that the Army was rude to you, but just to be clear, are you saying you've seen Marines or Army actually threaten citizens?
Yeah, I was walking up because I was with my cousin because she had just gotten out of, finished summer school and graduated high school and all that. And we were going to a McDonald's to celebrate because she wanted to get something to eat. And I see Army Rangers out, and I'm like, hey, what's going on? And I even told him I was in the Marine Corps, and he's like, look, you know what's best for you? You better shut up and go back to where you come from. And I mean, I stood my ground. I'm not scared of him. I mean, if you're going to mow me down in plain sight, I mean.
Oh, I know. I had Delta Force take our cameras and our footage in San Antonio, and Mike wouldn't give up his camera. So the guy just pulled a gun out and stuck it to Mike's chest.
Jeez.
And then Mike still wouldn't give it up. So they grabbed it away from him, and they hated us. And it wasn't the actual Delta Force operators. They were there. We'd gotten footage of them. It was the people with them. Whatever. It's all narcotics trafficking. God bless you. This country's just fried. I mean, they sit around selling baby parts. I mean, whatever. Does anybody feel safe in this country? Do your pension funds feel safe? If babies aren't safe, you're not safe. I'm not safe. Of course they let the veterans commit suicide 24 a day. Of course the veterans are the enemy. With the government. I mean, they know where the bodies are buried. Anthony in California, probably last caller we can go to. Sorry to Tim. Go ahead, Anthony.
Yes. Hi, Alex.
Go ahead.
Thanks for giving out all the info that you've given. I just want to talk to you about Jimmy Carter. I know you're probably on overdrive right now.
Yeah, he's got cancer.
I know he's dying of cancer. And he came out and he made a statement that that the USA is an oligarchy, no longer a democracy. And I just wanted to ask you what your take
is. Yeah, I think Jimmy Carter is a useful idiot. I think he means well. His answer would be socialism to stop an oligarchy. But no, he's absolutely on target saying we're an oligarchy with unlimited political bribery. But now that the globalists have conquered the country, they want to shut off political giving because they know we might be able to give money and counter them. So it's a complex issue, but I don't think Jimmy Carter is a bad man. I think he's very, very misguided. That's why they set him up. But I appreciate your call. What do you think?
Well, what I think, Alex, is that, you know, he's the only president besides JFK that's tried to do something. And besides Eisenhower and JFK.
No, I agree. And now that he's got cancer all over, supposedly all over his body, I think he's a goner probably. He ought to spill his guts.
Yeah, he ought to do that, you know, to expose what's going on. Listen, Alex, I really appreciate what you've done and what you're doing. If it wasn't for you, I just want to say thanks that I would have been dumbed down even further with sodium fluoride because I was taking Prozac.
Well, God bless you, brother. We're out of time. Nightly News tonight.